So first I pay respect to the Triple Gem, which is the cause of our meeting here. If there was not the Triple Gem, we would not be able to meet here and meditate together. And meditation is the essence of the Buddha's teachings. So especially when we face difficulties in life, and we are bound to face difficulties in life. Like right now, myself, I'm going through a very difficult period. All my information, email, Facebook, everything has been hijacked. So these are the times when the meditation is of great help. And we are all going to face difficult times. Make sure you learn to face them with meditation. This is what is Buddha's teaching about. There is a verse in the Dhammapada which says, na mata na pita na. No mother, no father, no relatives can do for us as much as a mind which has been properly controlled. No enemy can do to us more harm than the mind which has not been properly controlled. So the benefits of meditation are just beyond our grasp, because the state of Buddhahood is indeed the state beyond the grasp. What we can do is to try to approach that kind of state by developing interest and by developing enthusiasm, effort, faith in this state of perfect meditation that the Buddha has himself attained and made example for us. So precisely in the times when we are in trouble, the meditation is always our best friend. So I hope some of us have meditated before, some of us don't have much experience in meditation. I hope all of you, during this time you spend here, you will try hard to make meditation your life friend, who will always accompany you, especially in times of trouble. And these times of trouble, especially in our times, which is the fastest time ever we humans have experienced in the known history, the troubles are bound to happen. There is no way out of trouble. The teaching of the Buddha is the message that the trouble of the body cannot be avoided once we are born. But the troubles of the mind can be avoided. Definitely can. So if you have faith in Buddha's teachings, and I guess you turn up here because you have faith that the Buddha's teachings are of use to you. So message of the Buddha's teaching is nothing but that the mental suffering is not necessary if we learn meditation. Now, meditation is rooted in the effort to improve ourselves. And effort to improve ourselves means effort for becoming better person, more moral person, more aware person. So that is why it is a tradition in the Buddhist countries that the meditation retreat starts by taking the silas, the precepts. The meditation is nothing else but attaining the state free of defilements. Zhongwen, Omitobo.
<笑>那我先讲英文再中文，谁不能够听英文，请举手让我了解。有一位、两位、三位、四位、五位、六位。 那，我可能没有办法讲全部都讲英文跟中文，我只能够用中文归纳我所讲的英文的意思。然后如果不够清楚的话，我们每天晚上，有那个。 晚上又讲佛法开始，佛法开始是大概一个小时，佛法开始以后，有那个可以发问，所有的问题，特别那些不能够听英文的参加者，他们。 就可以弄清楚，好不好？因为如果要一边讲英文一边讲中文，那这样讲话的时间会很长，打坐的时间变成很短。我们要用功打坐，不要用功讲话。 有没有道理？那所以我很抱歉，那些中文的说明在英文后面，比英文变成短，只是归纳意思而已。OK, I have just explained because our aim here is to meditate, not to talk too much. So I will emphasize English and the explanations will be English. After the English explanation, I will just summarize shortly what has been said in Chinese. I have no way to say the same things in English and Chinese. It would be first, it would take too much time, and the second thing is I would have to speak sentence by sentence, because then I would maybe lose continuity and it would make things difficult for me and for you also. So I apologize to those who are not skillful in English. Maybe it will be a challenge for them to to try hard to understand. It is a tradition. It is tradition in Buddhist countries that the meditation retreat starts by taking the silas. The silas we translate as precepts. The Visuddhimagga, for example, explains silas by etymology of making oneself cool. What makes ourselves cool is a moral effort. One cannot remain cool while lying, while being insincere, by killing or harming others, by stealing. All these are states of unrightful action, which are states, expression of our agitated mind. We cannot do wrong actions without agitated mind. This is an insight actually in all religions. The aim of the religion is to purify the mind. And all religions claim that the purity of the mind is the highest blessing. There is no higher blessing than the purity of mind. Now, Buddhism especially emphasizes that this purity of mind comes through understanding. In Buddhism, in a way, the faith also is inseparable from understanding. So we are, as far as Buddhism is concerned, we are responsible for our actions, and we are the results of our actions. So we can, the practice of meditation is nothing else but the deep purification of the mind, which must be based on the purification of actions. So these precepts, their meaning is to purify our actions, to avoid killing, which can be done only in the state of anger and hate, to avoid stealing or sexual misconduct, which can be done only in a state of greed, and to avoid lying, which also can be only done, or wrong speech, which also can be only done in a state of ignorance based on anger and greed. So we really get into meditation by accepting the effort to purify our actions. Then our mind, the process of purification of the mind, which is meditation, can go deep. If we do not have aspiration to purify our actions, the purification of mind cannot take place effectively. So these precepts is nothing else but the expression of our effort to purify our actions in order to be able to purify mind. So in the Buddhist scriptures, like the Subha Sutta and so on, the Buddha explains also the sila as being nothing else than wisdom. The faith is wisdom, the sila or the precepts is also wisdom. When we are wise, we become moral. When we are not wise, we are unmoral. So with this understanding, let us try to take these precepts and keep them pure, because being moral will enable us to enter deeply into the science of purifying the mind, which will ultimately bring us the state of freedom from suffering, from mental suffering, I repeat. And this is the aim of Buddha's teachings. The Buddha did not teach anything else except the skillful means for the abandoning of suffering. And he taught that in accordance with our abilities, in our faculties, in our background, and developed innumerable skillful means to lead us to entering this process of purifying the mind. So I hope all of us believe firmly that the purity of mind is what you're looking for, and that you will here during this retreat try your best to be considerate to others who are trying to purify the mind, not to disturb them. If one disturbs the one who meditates, then it means one has no regard for meditation. If one has no high regard for meditation, one will never succeed in meditation. We will talk about it during the coming days. This is my job now, to explain how to meditate correctly and how to develop enthusiasm, faith and effort in meditation. These are the conditions for purifying the mind. Good. So let us just go through the eight precepts. Venerable Sudama Chichung Fashe has, I have heard outside, already explained the precepts, eight precepts should not be any problem. The only precept that may cause problem is the precept of not taking food after the sun zenith, after 12 o'clock. This, of course, this is not so important precept. It was important precept in the time of Buddha when the monks had to go on begging rounds. And why this precept happened, very interesting story, shall I tell you? One monk was standing at the entrance of the house, as we monks usually do when we go on begging around, and some lady giving feeding her infant saw that at the entrance of the door is a ghost. So she became very afraid seeing someone at the entrance of her door, so dropped the child, and the child became the child got injured. So she complained to Buddha, and the Buddha then coined this rule that no question of monks going on the begging round. So this is a background of the rule. All these rules, they have backgrounds. At the beginning of Buddha's mission, all Buddha's disciples were enlightened. So there were no rules. When everybody is enlightened, no rules, because the enlightened person does not do any nuisance. But eventually, in the community of the monks, as it became more and more respected due to the dignity of the Buddha and his disciples, many monks and nuns entered the Sangha, not due to pure motives. So all kinds of nuisances happen. So the more nuisances, the more rules. So this rule of taking, not taking food after noon, in a way, is because the monks and nuns lived a different kind of life. So nowadays we just go over to the dining hall. So we live a different style of life, but still it's very healthy to, if you eat in the evening, to take a very light meal. So a light meal will be provided, I think. What time? I don't know. Sudama should tell us. 5:30. Some light meal will be provided for those who need it. Now, it's okay to take some light meal. Sometimes it's very helpful because especially we're going to emphasize shamatha meditation, the concentration. and you need energy for concentration. So for developing good concentration, especially those who are not yet used to deep concentration, you need a lot of energy. You need to fight the enemies of defilements very vehemently. Only then you will be able to enter into deep concentration. So it's perfectly all right to take some light meal in the evening or to take some vitamins or whatever you need for supporting the energy of the body. You will need it for developing concentration. The other rules are for those who do not know. First rule is not killing. These are common to all religion. Not stealing. The third rule is during the retreat, of course, no question of sex. After the retreat, of course, the rule is gone. You are not obliged to avoid sex if you are married and so on. Of course, after the retreat, you just take the five precepts, not the eight precepts. But it is naturally, monastery is not a proper place for sex. So, you just take the rule of while the retreat is on, and no question of sex. Then no question of lying, no question of rash, harsh speech, and of useless talking. This is what I want to emphasize. Last time, some participants were trying hard and they were disturbed by other participants who engaged in useless talking. So please try to keep the noble silence. Of course, the most important things that need to be said can be said, but please keep noble silence. The noble silence is the condition for isolating the mind from useless thinking and from the sensual desire for sensual objects. And without reducing desire for sensual objects and reducing useless thinking, you will never go into meditation. So if you really intend to learn meditation, please keep noble silence in order to be able to learn viveka. Viveka, the isolation, is the condition for entering deep concentration. No question of entering deep concentration without isolating the mind. So please keep this that rule and try your best to limit the talk to minimum, so that when you go to meditation you have empty mind. So then during the retreat, also no question of taking any intoxicants. They will affect the mind, so that no one can meditate with mind intoxicated. Then the rule, the sixth rule, is not taking meal after 12 o'clock or afternoon. That rule, if you don't want to keep, you just don't say that. Vikala bhojana, you don't say that. The other rules are not taking any anything to make your body beautiful, like the some scents and cosmetics, that this is kind of a rule for getting detached from the body, which is also the condition for going into deep concentration. And then not using some high and comfortable seats, because they are also not conducive to a bodily isolation. Those who do not know how to meditate, even sitting on the throne with on the silk, and they will always be fidgeting around and will never get any stable bodily posture. And during this retreat we will emphasize steady bodily posture. We will do some yoga exercises, and I will teach you how to pay attention to the bodily posture, also in walking, in standing, in sitting, in lying down. The awareness of bodily postures is the base for entering into concentrated state of mind, in state of awareness. So these are the rules.
<笑>有没有 好，现在中文，我刚才讲什么？我刚才讲那个，在我们佛教里面，平常参加长修，第一步就是收戒。戒的意思就是，我们。 要我们的心为清净，来能够调心清净。调心清净就是修心的意思。心清净不可能，如果我们的心为不清净。谢谢。 心为清净，叫做什么？叫做不杀生，不拿别人的东西，不讲谎语，然后不邪淫，不喝酒那些让我们的心乱，然后。 刚才我有说明第六戒就是，午后不用餐，这个戒不是那么重要。如果你们习惯晚上用餐，可以发誓慈悲他在那个餐厅。 他会安排一些一些小事，不过晚上不要吃太多，不然身体中就不能够用功。那其他的戒就是不拿那些cosmetics怎么说那些。 不盘打扮脸面，不做自己漂亮。为什么？因为
来能够入定，我们要学放下身体，放下心，放下身体就是不执着身体。如果太执着身体，没有办法修定。修定就是的意思，就是放下。然后不着在很高的位置，这个也不是重要，因为我们这里没有高的位置。反正依照转动的方式，就是八节的意思就是这样。那现在你们知道意思，我是用巴利文，你们跟着我说。收戒之前也是佛教的传统，有三皈依。 I have just explained it is a Buddhist tradition. Before taking the precepts, we take the triple refuge to Buddha, Dharma and Sangha. Buddha, Dharma and Sangha, in for us Buddhists, they represent你有没有给他们用？
现在要放。
OK. Please distribute. Wonderful. So we have the Chinese, we have the English, we have the Pali. So we are fully equipped. So.So, before the precepts, as you see, we have the triple refuge. The triple refuge, why? Because in order to meditate effectively, we need support from the...We need support from the symbols of enlightenment. This triple refuge, the objects are the symbols of enlightenment. The Buddha is the one who has experienced enlightenment. The Dhamma is a way towards enlightenment. And the Sangha is the community of those who have actuallyexperience enlightenment. That is a true Sangha. If we have not experienced enlightenment, we are just the conventional Sangha, not the true Sangha. The true Sangha of the disciples and of the Bodhisattvas is the Sangha of those who have experienced directly that which is calledemptiness, which is called suchness, which is called nirvana, according to tradition, whatever you call it, it is that which is fulfilling. All other things are not fulfilling. But that thing is very fulfilling. Once you have experienced it, you become full. So it is the peculiarity of Buddhism, the difference of Buddhism from other religions is, in Buddhism you become full by experiencing emptiness. So please try to experience emptiness and become full. So these are the symbols of fullness in the sense of emptiness. When you empty yourself, you become full. Not a full, but full, full, full. That means you have plenty. Now we are lacking something because we are lacking emptiness. When we have realized emptiness, we are not lacking anything. So please try hard not to lack anything and experience emptiness. And the symbols of the emptiness, symbols of Nirvana, are precisely these: Buddha, Dhamma, Sangha. In order to experience emptiness, one needs a teacher. A teacher needs also a teacher, and the first teacher is a Buddha. In order to experience emptiness, you need also teachings. And in order to experience emptiness, you need association with those who have experience in the past towards emptiness, because it is very difficult to experience emptiness by oneself. This is a privilege of the Buddha himself. No others but the Buddhas can experience emptiness through their own efforts. We experience emptiness by association with so-called kalyana mittas or kalyana mitras, by noble friends. So the real sangha, the real community of monks, is a community of the noble friends who can show the path towards self-realization. The realization of emptiness is a self-realization. Not realization of the self in the sense of the cumbersome or heavy self, but in realization of the self which is the light, so light that it does not weigh anything. Okay, so we start by taking refuge. I have to explain in Chinese. Pa jie zhi qian you gui yi. Gui yi de dui xiang shi shei? Gui yi de dui xiang shi fo fa sheng. Fo fa sheng, ta men dai biao shi mo? Ta men dai biao kai wu de jin jie. Fo, 他有自己开悟, 我们不能够自己开悟, 来能够开悟, 我们要靠上知识, 真的生端就是上知识的生端, 上知识, 真的上知识是谁? 他有自己, 体会, 那个空的境界, 涅槃的境界, 这是我们的真的上知识。 所以它能够变成皈依。 那佛就是第一老师， 他所教的 叫做法， Let us start with the eight precepts procedure. It is a custom in the Buddhist tradition. The monk or the nun, they are the representatives of the teachings of the Buddha. The Buddha has given authority to the nuns and to the monks and nuns to transfer precepts so that the law that he has taught remains in its purity. So the official taking of the precepts is by requesting the monk who is representing the noble Sangha.藏宗的受戒的方式就是先在家居士要求法师给他受戒，因为佛转法僧端为对象，所以来让法流在 这个我们的世界里面，藏宗就是代表法清净，法清净是靠戒律清净，所以要藏宗的方式是先要求法师转戒，那要求就是三次，三次是代表我们的戒心。 如果没有决心了，没有办法修。三皈依也是三次，也是代表我们的决心。So please kindly repeat. I will recite in what is believed to be the original language of Buddhism, the language which Buddha is supposed to have used to convey his teachings. So please repeat after me. Qing Kenzer Wo Shuo. Okasa Aham Bhante Tisaranena Sadim Athanga Silam Dhammang Yachami Anugaham Tva silam detha me bhante dutiyampi okasa aham bhante tisaranena saddhim athanga silam dhammang yachami anugaham Katva silam detha me bhante tatiyampi okasa aham bhante tisaranena saddhim athanga silam dhammang yachami anugaham katva silam detha me bhante. So now please repeat after me again. Namo tassa bhagavato arahato samma sambuddhassa. Namo tassa bhagavato arahato Samma Sambuddhassa Namo Tassa
Bhagavato Arahato Samma Sambuddhasa. This is paying respect to the original teacher. And now the triple refuge. Please again repeat after me. Buddhang saranang gacchami, Dhammang saranang gacchami, Sanghang saranang gacchami, Dutiyampi Buddhang saranang gacchami, Dutiyampi Dhammang saranang gacchami, Dutiyampi Sanghang saranang gacchami, Tatiyampi Buddhang saranang gacchami, Tatiyampi Dhammang saranang gacchami, Tatiyampi Sanghang saranam gacchami, sarana gamanang sampunang. That is for the monk to say. It just means that the preliminaries have been completed. Now it's time to take the precepts. Panatipata Veremani Sikhapadang Samadhyami Adinnadana Veremani Sikhapadang Samadhyami Abrahmacharya Veremani Sikhapadang Samadhyami Musavada Veremani Sikhapadang Samadhyami. Actually in the eight precepts it's not only the false speech. In the eight precepts it's also the rough speech. Telling some bad things about the other behind, so liangshe, and speaking useless talk. So all this is included in the eight precepts, not in the five precepts, but in the eight precepts. So just remember it. Most important precept. Refrain from useless talking. It is a big obstacle to meditation. Sura Meraya Majja Pamadathana Veremani Sikhapadang Samadhyami. Now, if you like, you don't need to repeat. If you like to keep the whole precept, so you just repeat after me. But it's perfectly all right not to repeat. Don't feel ashamed. Vikala bhojana veramani sikhapadang samadhyami nacha Gita Vadita Visukadasana Mala Ganda Vilepana Dharana Mandana Vibhusanatana Veremani Sikkhapadang Samadhyami Uccha Sayana Maha Sayana Veremani Sikkhapadang Samadhyami Imam Attangamang Buddha Panyatang Uposatang Imancha Ratincha Imancha Divasam Samat Eva Abhirakitum Samadhyami. Okay, now Imani Atha Sikkhapadani Samadhyami Imani Atha Sikkhapadani Samadhyami Imani Atha Sikkhapadani Samadhyami. There are different versions of this. I do not know this version. So, anyway, at the end, the monk is reprimanding those who receive the precepts to keep the precepts pure. That's all. And apamadena, which is not here. Ah, yeah, it is here. Apamadena. Without negligence. There is a very, very wonderful verse in the Dhammapada which says Pamado machunopadam apamado amatampadam ye apamata namiyati ye pamata yatamata. The negligence is the way to death. The non-negligence, which means mindfulness, and we will try to spend these 3 weeks in mindfulness, is the way to deathlessness. Those who are negligent, those who are mindful, do not die. Those who are not mindful, who are negligent, even so they alive, they dead already. So please try your best to be alive, not to die during the retreat. I also myself looking forward to remain alive and try my best. If you can remain alive 50%, you already following the Buddha's teachings. If less than 50%, we should improve. If you are following 70%, you will get great clarity. If you follow 100%, you are an arahat. So please try your best. Okay, so what? 刚才说，那个受戒以后，呃，比丘出家人他提醒大家，呃，要保护那些戒清净，不翻译。为什么？刚才我有送那个发起经的一送，叫做如果，我们修正念，我们不修正念，就是翻译。那虽然我们还活着，在佛法里面，我们已经死了。所以一定要努力，那个3个星期还是1个星期看谁留多久？ Nuri Nuri Shu Zhen Yan. Woman Zhen Yan Chu Su Ding the Tiao Jian. Chi Su Zhen Yan the Yi Su Su Ding. Yo Zhen Yan Zai Yo Ding. Mayo Zhen Yan Chu Mayo Ding. Na Wu Tiga Sangha Sin Chi Wu Chu Yao Jie Su Yi Si. 修真念的方便，怎么真念为至观的基础？我就要说明。 Now in these coming days, I'm going to try my best to explain and practice myself the practice of the four bases of mindfulness as a base for samatha and vipassana. And I will try to use all kinds of skillful means to guide you for entering deep into the practice of samatha and vipassana through the practice of mindfulness. So let me read this last section. You can see the translation. 那我现在念最后的部分，你们可以看那个翻译。 Imani atta sikapadani ajekam ratin divam uposata sila vasena tumhehi upasaka upasika bhutehi sadukam akhandam katva apamadena rakhitabani. So now you say amabhante. We will try our best. I also try my best. So we will spend, I hope, 3 weeks in heaven. If you are in meditation, you are already in heaven, even so you're still on the earth. And the condition of meditating well is to keep the mindfulness practice going all the time. Then the mind will empty, and I guarantee there is no greater pleasure, no greater joy than empty mind. So now we still have a few minutes. I will explain what we shall be concerned with in this coming 3 weeks. 我现在要讲我们那个三个星期之内长修之内我们要学什么东西要修什么。 Our main concern during these 3 weeks will be, as I have mentioned, the practice of samatha and vipassana. The practice of samatha is the practice of the mind appeased and the mind non-distracted. That is the science of samadhi. Now, the term samadhi in Buddhism is a key term. It is, in a way, in whole of the Indian tradition, the meaning of yoga is the practice of samadhi. Buddhism is also nothing else, but as far as Indian tradition is concerned, is the science of yoga. Please be aware of it. Yoga, the true meaning of yoga means the link,
link with what? Link with that which is real in us and in the world. We practice the Buddhist yoga is nothing else than shamatha and vipassana, the meditation of appeasement and the meditation of insight, which is based on appeasement. Without appeasement of mind, no insight. So this will be our concern in the coming 3 weeks, so that we appease our mind, and on the base of the appeased mind, we then experience the true nature of reality. The Buddhism, as different from other religions, emphasizes that the freedom from suffering can only come when we directly realize the reality as it really is. So in that sense, it is more philosophy than religion, in the sense as we as it is understood here in the West. But the original meaning of religion is also, those who have studied Latin know, is religere, to bind together, which is also the meaning of yoga. The religion is yoga, and yoga is a religion. The binding, rebinding. Rebinding to what? To rebinding to the real. The real is understood usually in this part of the world as a God, but for the Buddhist, the real, of course, we have no objection to God, but the not God as a creator, but the seeing things as they really are. Knowing things as they really are, seeing things as they really are, is living in reality, is binding to the real. According to Buddhism, we are living in our own dreams. So it is time to wake up. And the process of waking up is precisely learning the shamatha and vipassana. So the shamatha and vipassana means then linking to the real, means a real yoga, means the Tao of the Buddhists. And we want to enter this practice of linking to the real through the most important practice of Buddhism, the practice of mindfulness. The mindfulness is the base for both, for appeasement and for insight. Without mindfulness, no question of appeasement, no question of insight. The act of being mindful is act of concentrated mind. So without concentrated mind, no question of practicing mindfulness. So what I am going to teach you in the coming days is the skillful means of keeping the mind concentrated. We will learn also some practice of awareness of postures connected with some basic yogic asanas, yogic postures which develop mindfulness. According to Buddhist teachings, our false idea of an existence of self and what belongs to the self, so explained in the Samyutta Nikaya, is greatly due to our misunderstanding, not understanding the postures. So awareness of the postures will be also a part of our effort here. So we will spend some time explaining the correct way of sitting, correct way of standing, correct way of walking. Then also how to enter into the deeper state of concentration. And for entering the deeper state of concentration, the most suitable object of concentration is breath. Just like I have explained, because of lack of awareness of bodily postures, we have the very deep-rooted idea of the self. Similarly, due to misunderstanding of the process of breathing, we have this idea of self. The breath, among all the elements of that make us, is the most revealing element, in the sense that it is inseparable from the experience of our body and the mind. We are aware of the body and the mind in the act of breathing. And according to Buddhism, the mind and the body is everything we experience in this universe. According to Buddhism, also very important to understand, the meaning of this universe are we, the sentient beings. Without the sentient beings, the universe has no meaning. So the meaning of the universe, the meaning of ourselves, we can only understand through understanding of our body and the mind. And the understanding of the body and the mind comes most clearly through the practice of meditation on breath. The breath in Indian tradition, not only Indian tradition, also in our Western tradition, has always been associated with the soul. There is no, it is not an accident that the self is called in Sanskrit Atman, or Atta in Pali, and the related word to that is like in German, Atmen. Atmen means breathing. In the Greek, the Greeks, the Jews also, they also conceived breath as a soul. In the Upanishads, if you read like Prashna Upanishad, the breath is or prana is identified with God, and God is identified with self. So in Buddhism we don't speak of self, we speak of non-self. And the meditation on breath is precisely the best skillful means of realizing the non-self, in the sense that What keeps our body and mind together is the act of breathing. Act of breathing brings our mind and body together. When we die, and we are all bound to die, and we learn meditation in order to die in a dignified way, in a wise way, not as a fool. When we die, medical person will understand that we are gone, he will put a mirror in front of our nose or in front of our mouth, and if there is no vapor in it, then he will call the priest or a monk like this or like that to do the last ritual. So the breath is with us as long as our mind and body is together, and we are alive because we have mind and body together. So the meditation on breath is the most highly regarded meditation in the Buddhist tradition. The reason being, among others, that Buddha himself, according to the tradition, he realized what he has realized under the Bodhi tree with the help of meditation on the breath. He remembered under the Bodhi tree, as in his young days, when he was still a child, he could attain the state of absorption of mind on the breath during the plowing festival, where he was resting under the jambu tree, wulian tree, waiting for his father to complete the task of plowing the field. In old India, the ruler of the country had to plow the field first, then the farmers would start plowing. This custom is still prevalent in some places. So the leader of the community starts the plowing season, and an agricultural society, all dependent on the success of agriculture. So the Buddha at the time, Bodhisattva, was waiting for his father under the jambu tree, he spontaneously, due to his previous practice, concentrated on breath and entered the state of absorption, which we will try to emphasize during the coming days. And he remembered that state under the Bodhi tree, and that brought him to the more deeper practice of the absorptions, that means to supernatural knowledges by which he could see the nature of the world being the dependent origination, and how we beings, in accordance to the law of karma, are reborn again and again, as long as the conditions of being reborn are there. Then he has been teaching this message of understanding things as they really are, as the means of attaining purity of mind, which is the aim of all religions, during the rest of his life. So this meditation on breath is very important, and we will emphasize that. We will also use the skillful means of study of bodily postures in regard to the breath. And then we will try to combine with some basic practice of insight based on concentration on breath. Then some of us have been practicing meditation before, then those who have already attained the deeper concentration on breath, they can use it to study other meditations. So that is what we are going to learn in the coming days, starting tomorrow. Since tomorrow is the first day, so I will give early in the morning. We start 5:30 with morning service. Then I will give just a gist for those who have not yet meditated, how to meditate, explanation. Then we will learn more about the how to sit correctly during the yoga exercise. And then in the evening I will start giving a more detailed explanation on the meditation on the breath, and connect it with some general theories of practice of shamatha and vipassana as it is preserved in the northern and the southern tradition. We will emphasize the practice of shamatha and vipassana as a parami. Parami means the skillful means for being able to help oneself and others without distinction. So we will emphasize that we are learning meditation, not separating ourselves from others. We experiencing meditation. We experience the ability to be useful to oneself and others. This is what we're going to emphasize. And this is precisely what the Buddha did. So I may also explain some general principles of the practice of shamatha and vipassana as a parami in the whole structure of the parami practice. So now what remains is to summarize what I have said in Chinese, and after that, time to take rest. We start tomorrow with, we say in German, voll Dampf, with a full steam. So I hope you try your best. The meditation is also, I will explain tomorrow, nothing else but also effort to overcome laziness. Laziness is the enemy number one of meditation. So if we want to get into meditation, as the scriptures explain, the condition is the practice of mindfulness and the effort. When we are mindful and put effort, the meditation becomes easy. When meditation becomes easy, life is different. And I hope all of us have turned up here in order to make life different, to make it better, and to be useful to oneself and others. This is the aim of meditation.
好, 那现在我用中文归纳。
我看我的闹钟是8点35分, 这里是8点40分, 哪一个是对, 哪一个是不对, 那边是, 这个才对。 好, 那我调, 跟,
time set.
,我们佛教里面只观的修行,叫做佛教一切,我们佛教里面只观的修行,叫做佛教一切,一切的意思,刚才我有讲,就是相应,相应跟什么,相应跟实事,跟真理相应,依照佛法,我们多半时间就是做梦,因为做梦,所以我们跟真理不相应,因为跟真理不相应,我们的心乱,没有办法做办事情好,心乱,什么都做得不好。 所以佛教的一切叫做直观,直观就是跟真理相应,跟事实相应。只是佛道,来修
直观就要起来,不做梦,不做梦的方便就是真念。因为不真念,所以我们一直在打妄想,跟事实不相应。所以难怪我们的心不安。 结果这几天我们要特别强调那个真念的修行。真念的修行的方便是第一方便就是阿那巴念，阿那巴念就是熟悉。第二方便就是思维一，思维一叫做 打坐、坐、静心、张桌跟单桌的时候，用正念，这就是不断的用正念。我所要教的方便就是一些一切姿势，简单的一切姿势来。 一方面调身体健康，一方面来修正念，这样好吗？ 我还要讲什么？
我还有提到在我们佛教里面熟悉是算最有效的方法来体会无我的境界。无我的境界就是空的境界，空的意思是什么？空的就是意思就是不属于我。 因为不属于我，所以空。在西方，我们这里西方界也是在印度，呼吸的意思跟我的意思是差不多。呼吸就是灵魂。 希腊哲学也是印度哲学也是，他们以为我们的灵魂就是我们的呼吸，我们的气，呼吸跟气很密切的关系，所以他们其实是同义词。所以来佛教阿那巴那念还是熟悉为最有效的方便。 来体会无我的境界，体会这个呼吸，是呼吸的意志，就是一方面是身体，一方面是心。依照佛法，身心在我们的这个世界里面，是我们的经验的全部。了解身心，就是了解全部。 了解全部就是了解全部是无我，了解全部是无我就是解决所有的问题。那。 时间差不多到了，请好好休息。明天加油，我们要特别努力学正念的修行，正念的修行的方便。最后，每次我们。 回想，at the end, we will always do the practice of transference of merit. 你有没有中文的回想？ 这是巴利文，无所谓，可以。请跟着我说， please kindly repeat with me. Aka satta chabumattha deva naga mahidika punyantang anumoditva chiram rakantu loka sasanang. Aka satta chabumattha deva naga mahidika punyantang anumoditva chiram rakantu desanang. Aka satta chabumattha deva naga mahidika punyantang anumoditva chiram rakantu tumamparang eta vata chamehi sampadam punya sampadam
sabbe deva anumodantu sabba sampati siddhya eta vata cha amehi sampadam punya sampadam sabbe bhuta anumodantu sabba sampati siddhya eta vata cha amehi sampadam punya sampadam sabbe satta anumodantu sabba sampati siddhya bhavaga upadaya avici hetato etantara satakaya upapana rupi arupi asanya sanyino dukkha muchantu fusantu nibutim sadhu 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 omitopo. Samatha is the state of appeasement and non-destruction of mind based on one-pointedness of mind. I will explain tomorrow.